Hi, my name is Megan Rossman. I'm the public horticulture intern here at the Scott Arboretum. And in today's lunchtime tour, we'll be going over some fantastic fall foliage. I was talking to Rowan, our assistant horticulturist here at the Arboretum earlier today, who's from Vermont, and he was telling me that this is one of the best falls he thinks at here at the Scott Arboretum. And that's saying something. You know, he's from the land of color and all these amazing trees, so it was really impactful to me to hear that he thinks that this is a great fall. I'm from Colorado and we really only have aspen trees, which grow, you know, glow a beautiful yellow, but to start seeing these reds and oranges is something really special to me. And I hope I can share with you some of that special color on today's tour. Our first tree on this tour today is gonna be the Cercidophyllum japonicum, also known as the Katsura tree. It's located here beneath Clothier Hall near to the peony collection. It is the class of 1982 class tree, and what I particularly like about it is the way it looks from far away. You have these kind of deep, dark brown branches intermixing with these golden leaves, and it really creates this nice silhouette. And I just think the branches are really highlighted in this tree with its fall color. When you get up close to it, it has this beautiful, almost scraggly bark. It's kind of loose. It almost looks like it's falling off in a more deciduous way. And I just think the appearance, both far away and close up, is really attractive. This tree is about 51 feet tall, which is right in its mid-range for its height. It looks beautiful in the spring when it emerges kind of with light red leaves, which mature to green and then form yellow in the fall. I just think it's lovely both close up and far away. Right next door to the Katsura tree is the Pseudolarix ambivalis, or the golden larch. This beautiful deciduous evergreen is in the family of metasequoias and taxodium, meaning that it loses its needles during the fall. From green, they turn this beautiful golden, and they then fall to the ground, creating a lovely yellow carpet. Although the common name is larch, it is not a common larch, and it differs in the cones and the needles, which are usually longer and broader than those of a larch. These deciduous conifers grow best in moist, acidic, organically rich loams in full sun and may struggle with hot and humid summers. However, I think that this tree is doing wonderfully here at the Scott Arboretum despite this past summer. And like I said, we have metasequoias and taxodium, which are also deciduous evergreens, but the ones here at Scott Arboretum have not started turning color yet. This is neat. This Acer palmatum dissectum is a wonderful tree in the fall. This one's in its a little bit later stages of fall color, but we do have some others on campus that are just starting to turn color, such as the Acer palmatum dissectum that's also a heritage tree below the library. That one hasn't quite started its full color yet, so that one would be a great one to kind of check out here on campus. I really love getting in and amongst these trees because you can really start seeing how their trunks are moving, especially the one underneath the library creates this beautiful kind of enclosure space, and with that fall color just makes it even more special and neat. Welcome to outside Dana and Dowell Hall, where we are at the Oxydendron Arborum, this beautifully kind of peachy leaf right now. This tree is about 51 feet. It grows 20 to 60 feet normally. And I just think everyone, when I was asking what trees should I show in this tour, talked about this tree. It's just got these beautiful, almost iridescent red leaves. And it's really striking within the canopy of kind of this yellow and green of these slowly transitioning trees. This tree is more dependent upon the weather for its changing color. In full sun, it's really gonna get those lovely reds. And you hear a lot from different weather people or kind of fall foliage predictors about, you know, this is gonna be a great leaf year, or the leaves won't be great this year. And that's due to weather. So when we think about what's happening with leaves changing in the fall, it is dependent upon weather somewhat. So as days become shorter and colder, chlorophyll production in the leaves slows to a stop, and other pigments in the leaves get a chance to show themselves. There's two primary pigments in the leaves. There's carotenoids, which are responsible for the orange, yellows, and browns we see, And these carotenoids are present in the leaves year-round and get to shine when chlorophyll takes a break. The yellows, orange, and browns due to these pigments are not weather-dependent. However, unlike the orange, yellows, and brown pigment, which is available in the leaves year-round, the red pigment, the anthocyanins, are not around year-round, and they depend on light. So the pigment, the anthocyan, that is present in the Oxydendron arboretum, this sourwood we see here, is created in response to light, plant chemical changes, temperature, and water supply. Warm days and low temperature at night boost the production of red pigments, but early frost will weaken the color. So this beautiful red, almost iridescent, that we're seeing of this sourwood here is a response from the proper production of this pigment that led to this just glorious colors thanks to the weather we've had this fall. One of the first really striking trees that turned here at Scott Arboretum was the Acer Saccharum Green Mountain, or the sugar maple. And despite this being one of the, you know, earlier species to really show its fall colors, it's still lasting. Obviously, we're losing a couple leaves here at the top, but what I really like about this tree is that it just creates this absolutely gorgeous carpet of yellows and reds and kind of this iridescence that kind of just makes the ground and the surrounding leaves and branches glow. This tree is located near an old tarble and the Ben West house. It is about 29 feet tall, and this specific cultivar, Green Mountain, is known for its rapid growth rate, central trunk, which is nice and straight, and it is also resistant to leaf hoppers and leaf scorch. It will grow to 40 to 60 feet with a spread of 25 to 45 feet. So if you are planning to use this at home, make sure you have space for it. It creates a lovely canopy that is really nice and kind of rounded in its habit. And I think this is a tree that you don't really want up close next to other trees, because you want to be able to appreciate and value it from far away, looking at how it's growing. It dislikes air pollution and compaction, so we would not recommend this at a street tree at all, but it would be great for a backyard where you're really able to appreciate it and enjoy the wonderful carpet of leaves that it creates. We're here in the upper biostream, and we're next to the Amsonia hubrictii, also known as the Arkansas Blue Star, and this is just a lovely plant, and it has been really well utilized here at the Scott Arboretum. It has three seasons of interest, so in the spring you're going to have a lovely kind of cloud of blue to purple flowers. In the summer, you're going to have a really reliable, very dense needle-like green with the feathery foliage. And then in the fall, as you see here, it turns into just this beautiful kind of cascading wade of these umbers and oranges and kind of these burnt colors. And it does change gradually. So you have some greener tones at the bottom and some red tones from the stem. And I think it creates movement even when it's still. But when it does get a slight breeze, it just kind of shimmers. It's really reliable. It is more drought tolerant. It grows in partial shade to full sun. So it's a great plant if you're looking for something that you don't really have to worry about, but gives great full texture to your garden, and also is just lovely three season of interest. Moving over to the Terry Shane Teaching Garden, right here we have the Hydrangea quercifolia Snow Queen. What's lovely about the Hydrangea quercifolia, or oak leaf hydrangeas, is that they get these lovely maroon leaves. So you still have these brown bracts, which are the flower panicles right here. And I just think the combination of the brown bracts versus these kind of slowly changing maroon to red leaves is just a beautiful kind of color combination that adds a lot of depth and interest to the garden. What's great about the Snow Queen hydrangea is that it has really strong stems. So during the summer, during the fall, if you get any heavy rains, these stems are going to stay upright. They're not going to flop over. And even when these are heavy with blooms, they're also going to stay upright. And just these long-lasting flower bracts really add late fall and even early winter interest. So again, keep an eye out on all your hydrangea quercifolia. The more sun they get, the more they're going to turn color. So obviously this one is a southern-facing hydrangea cordifolia, so it's getting more sun. That's why we have these dramatic reds like we talked about before. Here we have another view of the Oxydendron Arborum sourwood, just to get a really wonderful close-up view of just how fluorescent red these leaves are. There's many members of the Arboretum team that say this is one of their favorite trees for fall color. These trees are a little bit younger, so they're obviously not quite as tall as the other species we saw near Dana and Dwell Hall. But another just great example of how they really kind of spice up this landscape. We're near Willits Hall right now, and we have, I think, maybe four or five of them here. And just with these evergreens and these trees that haven't started to change yet, they just create this, it's just like neon color, and I think it's lovely. Right here, we have the Acer rubrum Sun Valley, or red maple. We're located here on College Ave, and this is another great example of a maple that has exceptional fall color and is in a variety of stages of changing as well. We have some green leaves, we have some red leaves, and I think it's really lovely when you can get that transition and you see it. So the Acer rubrum Sun Valley can grow to a height of 20 to 35 feet. However, this specimen we have here goes quite over that, up to 50 feet. It tolerates a wide range of soils, but prefers moist soils that are well drained. It is native to eastern North America, and it is a U.S. National Arboretum introduction, being a cross between Red Sunset and Autumn Flame. This selection is noted for having symmetrical ovate crown and, like I said, exceptional red color. And what a beautiful tree to welcome you into the Scott Arboretum. I love seeing this on my walk here every day. Here we are outside of the Nason Garden, where we have a couple Acer japonicum aconitifolium, or full moon maples. We have a couple here in various stages of fall color. So this one, which is getting really nice maroons, still has some of its greens. We have some that are getting a little bit more orange. And then we also have some that are just neon red. I love when you have a grove of kind of similar trees like this, but they're all at various stages. It really shows what we talked about with that red pigment, how sun and light matters when you're looking at the changing of these leaves. This full moon maple, is a shorter maple, so it can be a shrub or also pruned up to a small tree. It grows 8 to 10 feet, and it grows in zones 5 to 7, so it's definitely on the edge of its range here at Scott Arboretum. Its common name comes from the leaves, which apparently look like full or half moons during certain angles. And what I really was caught when looking at this specimen in particular is how the leaves look against this kind of thick bed of grass that we have here. Nason is known for being a texture garden, and I think that this vision right here really emphasizes that texture and also bringing some color into this texture here. I love just the red against the dark green, and I think it really is fantastic fall foliage. Another Acer rubrum that's really showing its transition into color is the Acer rubrum October Glory, another red maple. Across from the Whittier parking lot by the Science Center, we have a few of these trees in a sort of pseudo allée. And I really notice these because it has this purple periphery and this beautiful green interior as the leaves on the outside start to change before the inside leaves. Being from Colorado, you know, I only get these beautiful golds. So seeing this deep, deep red that's almost purple is very foreign to me and has been very exciting to watch change. Acer rubrum October Glory grows in full sun and is very tolerant of a variety of soils. It is better adapted to areas with mild winters and hot summers. That here in Philadelphia does great. It is pollution tolerant, and if you're looking for an Acer to grow as a street tree, this is definitely a better choice. It is all right with compaction, it is all right with pollution, and again, just gives this beautiful transition of color. So in this tour, we've mentioned a lot of different maples, from Acer rubrums, to Acer japonicums, to Acer sacrums, the sugar maples, red maples, and Japanese maples. And a different kind of way to tell them apart is based on their leaf edges. So with Acer sacrums right here, we have the sugar maple right here, and you can see that the edge is nice and smooth. And that's one way to kind of tell what maple we have here. Acer sacrums, the sugar maples, tend to have smooth edges. When you get to the Acer rubrums, the red maples, you have a bit more of a serrated edge, so it's a little bit spiky. And then when you get to the Acer japonicums, you have a pretty different leaf shape here in general, so it's a little bit easier to tell. But I think it's wonderful that we have three different leaf shapes here, all coming from the same genus of trees, and they all give wonderful, wonderful fall color. The Acers in general tend to be some of the earlier trees to change color before the oaks and the other trees we have here at the Scott Arboretum. This is what we've noticed changing sooner, and they also just give that really spectacular red and deep oranges. Behind Kohlberg on the north side, we have Ham Malus Fireblaze, or the hybrid witch hazel. I wanted to end with something that's, you know, coming back towards the yellow theme, since we've seen a lot of reds and oranges. And what I really liked about this witch hazel is that the inner growth on the inside is still green, but the periphery in the vase shape is this beautiful yellow. There are little brown leaves, but I think that adds to this wonderful kind of camouflage, disco color it's got going on. Just has that beautiful green interior and the yellow exterior. This hybrid witch hazel grows 9 to 12 feet, and I really enjoy its vase shape. Thank you so much for joining me on our virtual lunchtime tour going over fantastic fall foliage. Again, everything we saw today is ever changing, and we have new fall color coming in every day and some fading out. So it's best to come and enjoy it for yourself if you can, to see what we've got going on campus. We only looked at a few, but we definitely have more examples of just brilliant, brilliant color going on right now. So if you can make it to the Arboretum, that would be fantastic. If not, I hope we gave you a good sense of what we've got going on here. We are open dawn to dusk, 7 days a week, and we hope you can join us here at the Scott Arboretum.